Product Spotlight. It is Wednesday and I am Dave Cooper. So today, is hempcrete a sustainable alternative to a traditional brick and concrete block home? Created from completely natural mix of hemp, lime, water. Learn more about the load-bearing hempcrete blocks as a negative carbon option for building materials. So we're going to be talking about hemp if you haven't picked up on it. And today is all about hempcrete. So today on the show, we have Mandi Kerr, who is the CEO and founder of the Global Hemp Association, a nonprofit organization dedicated to creating global economic sustainability through industrial and hemp. And we also have Glen Donoghoe on the show today, director of GeoSIP Ltd, trading as HempBLOCK Australia and HempBLOCK USA. That's right, HempBLOCK USA. You're going to find out that there might be some HempBLOCK homes getting built here in the near future, somewhere near you. So with that said, at Dave Cooper Live, we are bringing you the people and the processes that are building it better. Our guests and topics include experts in building systems, the building science, building codes, and the tech used to build it better. Today and always, we are seeking out the best and the brightest in construction and discovering all of the ways that innovative buildings come to life. That's right. We are not going to continue building how we used to build. So we can't do all of these wonderful shows without our sponsors. So big shout out to Forward Solutions Group, Ben Hershey and Joe Butler. They are a team with more than 175 years of experience developing and specifying manufacturing for panelized, volumetric, and modular industries with best practices in development and implementation. They offer consulting with investors, developers, manufacturers, and builders, and using offsite manufacturing methods, Forward Solutions is driving companies to succeed where others have failed. Please contact Ben at forwardsolutionsgroup.com. And also to our sponsor, Howick. Howick is a pioneer in the technology of precision light steel roll forming machines. For over 40 years, their commitment to innovation in cold form steel, also known as light gauge steel, precision manufacturing, uncompromising quality, and exemplary customer service have always defined the Howick way. Their commitment underpins the competitive advantage enjoyed by their customers. To learn more, visit their website, HowickLTD. All right, everybody, this is going to be a lot of fun on this show today. We are streaming to you live from the Tetons. Yes, we found internet. You would never think it's hard to find internet in this country, but I can tell you for sure it gets difficult when you're out here in the parks. With that, we're going to bring on Mandi Kerr first. We're going to talk about what her role is globally in regards to hemp. Hemp around the country is gaining a name and popularity. We're hearing a lot more about it in the building industry and looking forward to discussing it. Before we go there, I want you to like right now if you are interested in following and subscribing to us on YouTube. So hit that like button because we are live on LinkedIn, YouTube, Facebook, and Twitch. And remember, follow us on YouTube so you can watch all of these shows before and after they air. All right, without further ado, let's bring on Mandi. Mandi, how are you today?
I'm very good. Thank you for having me. Hello.
Yeah, this is so much fun. Who would have ever thought I would have woke up one day and said, I'm going to have Mandi Kerr on the show. You have like 20 some thousand followers on LinkedIn. You're part of the, you know, you're kind of heading up the Hemp Association globally and driving it forward. And we're hearing so much about it in the building industry. So this is going to be an interesting conversation. I'm expecting a lot of people to tune in. But before we do that, we want to know everything about you from the moment you were born to this very moment in time, and do not leave out any of the good stuff from the hospital or we will call your mother, and you only have 2 minutes to do it. So go for it.
I love it. Well, ironically enough, I'm from Wyoming, where you happen to be. And so that's great. Born and raised in Wyoming, moved to Utah actually in 2005, got married, raised a few kids, and about 5 years ago, dove into the workforce. Really head first. I married my job, I say. But I really found out where my personality traits are and where I belong in the connectivity place or piece. And so when I got into the cannabis industry and realized that there just wasn't an opportunity for people to come together and learn or educate or figure out who's who, create sales, anything that comes along business with business, I immediately started creating events or hosting events. And then when the pandemic happened, I switched to online and virtual events with the intent of providing a one-stop shop for people to come and connect to other people within the industry. And I really focused on the fiber or the industrial manufacturing side of hemp. And so instead of the cannabinoid side, I really focused on building materials, construction materials, biofuels, right, plastics, grain, fiber, and so forth. Yeah.
So, you know, so hemp is starting to grow in popularity, like we talked about. And I think there's a lot of misconception around hemp and pot, right? And what we're smoking and, you know, what we're smoking. I don't even smoke it, but if I did, it would be good stuff.
Maybe we should be.
Right? The way I'm stuttering today, it must be the mountain air. You know, we're still 6,000 feet up or something like that here. Why is the popularity of hemp and products and clothing, building material, why is it gaining such popularity so quickly?
Oh, I think that we're seeing a pull from consumers. Consumers are really concerned about, you know, the chemicals, how things are being sourced, making sure they're ethically sourced, knowing that they're taking care of their local community, that they're not pulling from all over the world to source materials, because the awareness, I think, is coming back to the value of local source, local manufactured, and local grown.
Right. And the ability, it grows fast. Yeah.
Well, okay. So yeah, then let's talk about hemp in general as to, yeah, how fast we were able to grow the carbon footprint, what we're able to do both on the crop side and the manufacturing side, you know, end products. You know, we have an opportunity to introduce a new crop as a rotation crop or a crop to our row of, I don't know what word I'm looking for, to our agriculture, right?
Yeah,
I
think right.
It hasn't happened for a long time. Thomas Jefferson said the best thing we can do is introduce a new crop. And here we have the opportunity to compete on a much more sustainable and ethical platform, with all of these other commodities.
Sure. And in your role right now, I mean, you're working with people all over the world. I mean, even today, you know, Glenn, who's going to come on, is over, you know, France, right? And other parts of the world. So I think this is really interesting to understand from your eyes. Are you seeing more so the United States? Are you seeing other parts of the world kind of embrace this faster than the United States? Or is it kind of on par just using hemp in general?
I think it depends. Some we're ahead of, right? And others were behind. We haven't had an opportunity to study it where other countries may have, and have had the opportunity then to certify different pieces. But then there are others that are just now legalizing hemp. And so I think the United States is really known and looked after for our entrepreneurship, you know, and I think for that, we will naturally put ourselves in the running on a competitive global scale.
Yeah, for sure we will. For sure we will. So this is going to be a good conversation. Hopefully you're going to join us. We're going to bring Glenn on here in a few minutes, and we're going to talk about Glenn's product. Tell us a little bit how you got to know Glenn and how did you two get involved with each other?
So I host a number of events in the association. My goal has been to connect people to the supply chain. So I host 8 to 12 events a month. And I was connected to Glenn in the search for a product that was being manufactured and sold into the market currently, and especially with the interest of bringing it into the United States. The competitive, the cost of wood and lumber right now, the housing shortage, and our ability to manufacture a much more eco-friendly and sustainable product really drove me on a search. And I was introduced to Glenn and really impressed by what he's doing. And yeah. So now I've built a relationship, and I'm really eager to watch what he's doing into the marketplace.
Yeah, for sure. And he has a great accent, right?
I love it.
Great accent. In fact, France or Australia, we're going to bring him on. He's going to correct me soon. I think I messed myself up on that one, right? But all right. So Mandi, let's talk about the vision of hemp, where it's going, how fast you see it taking hold in the economy with the sustainability side of this. You're in the supply chain world of how hemp, I guess, really gets to adopted, how you're bringing people together globally to look at hemp. You're running a lot of, you do streams like we do as well. You're holding a lot of these conversations. How does this all tie in? And then once we talk about that, we'll bring Glenn into the conversation.
We have an opportunity to change the way that we're building, right? To change the way that we're constructing. We have an opportunity to take care of our rural communities and provide another source of income to our farmers. And really where it goes back is to, you know, the value or the component for additional or increased yields on crops, right? And then when we talk about our building material, our carbon footprint, you know, if we have something that is, you know, more sustainable as far as a fire rating or insulation, that is, has a better R value, you know, we can create a more sustainable, a home that lasts longer at a lower cost and produce and manufacture them locally, you know, bringing back manufacturing within our borders. And through the association, I've been able to watch from almost a bird's eye view at how this is playing out on a global scale and lean into countries that are ahead of us, you know, and into organizations that have learned from mistakes where we don't really necessarily need to. And on the flip side, provide opportunity to, you know, places like Utah that hadn't had any manufacturing prior to now.
Yeah. Well, and that's really it, right? Bringing manufacturing here back to the States is always been a big topic of conversation, but it takes a global collaboration to make that happen because there are people already doing it. There are people that have already gotten approvals in other countries for these products in different parts, which the approval process is a very, very big deal when we're bringing it here to the States or anything new for that matter. And I think this is going to be an interesting conversation with Glen. So I think that's a good intro to bring Glen in because he's going to know all about the approval part of this, I'm sure. So, all right, here we go. Glen Donoghoe. Hey, Glen, thank you for the show. I'm really excited to have you on along with us to talk about this.
I've lost your sound, Dave. I can't hear you anymore.
Oh, Mandy, can you hear me? I wonder if you're muted. No. How about you, Glen? Can you hear me now?
Dave, I've lost your sound. I can't hear.
Glen, can you hear me?
Damn.
Can you hear me?
So Glen was talking about he was having issues because they were doing new fiber optics where he's at, and that might be part of the issue that he's currently having. But we're going to have Glen. We're going to be talking about HempBLOCK here in just a second. Maybe, Jen, can you send him some private chats to just jump out and jump back in would be the best thing to do? Let me do that.
I'm gonna send him in the private chat just a little comment to say it.
So, there you go. Yeah.
But yeah, there's lots and lots of opportunity when it comes to the building and building materials. It's been impressive watching. You know, and can I share something really quick? When we talk about the time frame at which it's grown or the amount of product we can produce per acre, you know, it's something like four times the amount of herb.
Right.
That compared to 1 acre of, so 1 acre of wood and 1 acre of hemp. Hemp produces four times the product in 120 days, you know, compared to 20 years. And so when we put that into consideration against the struggle we're having with wood or lumber, you know, we really can make a big impact on our building and construction.
Yeah. Right. I mean, think about that. Four times the amount. Lumber is up, you know, well, it was 275% plus. And here we have a product that is very viable. You know, there's some, like we're about to talk about, has been tested and has been through numerous tests. And it is a usable block product that they've come up with. It's kind of making sense, you know, when it comes to sustainability, low carbon footprints, all of the different things that are happening. So I really do believe that, you know, this is definitely going to be the future or in our future going forward, especially if they can't figure out this lumber issue.
And look at the way things have been constructed, right? If we're looking at some of the modulars or model homes or modulars or some of the homes that are built on the tribe, right? If we can create a product that lasts longer because it's mold resistant or, you know, under 9,000 degrees or 9 hours of direct flame at 7,000 degrees, you get a 16th inch in damage. You know, those are big and impactful numbers that we can change when we're, you know, look at the California market and the fires and as global warming happens, right? And we see this concern that, you know, I brought up earlier with carbon and what we're doing with the fire, you know, the number of fires and drought or.
Right.
It's an ongoing opportunity.
I love it. Glen, just so everybody knows, Glen's trying to connect and I don't know where his difficulty. We had this awesome stream right before the show, so who knows what's going on, you know? Well, it's a long distance maybe. But, you know, talking about fires and talking about hemp, and if you're joining us and you have questions, please put them in the comments. Put a queue in front of it because, yeah, we're buying a little bit of time while Glenn figures out his technical difficulties here. But, you know, put it in the comments because even with the product that Glenn is going to talk about today, it doesn't start on fire. Contrary to popular belief, not all hemp products burn. is that an accurate statement, Mandy?
Mm-hmm.
Where does it, you know, let me take another role from a political standpoint, from getting the buy-in and people wanting to allow hemp into the market, you know, is I see Glenn's coming back in. We'll go back to that in 1 second. And what is the biggest hurdle for hemp? Is it politics?
I think it's standards at this point. You know, especially in the building and construction material, you know, and we're playing this chicken and egg game right now of cost. We have to have processing and investment for processing in order to reduce cost and get it in the main market, right?
Right.
Our mainstream is not going to purchase product when it's more than 20%. And regardless of how sustainable it is, we've got to drive costs down. And with that, we have to have capital investment. And so it's this back and forth. And when we have someone like Glenn that's producing and already proof of concept, it just it speeds up our process to bring it into market. And I think, again, the standards piece becomes a big hurdle when we're producing.
Yeah, for sure. Well, let's bring Glenn in. I think Glenn's with us here. Hopefully we got his sound. Glenn, are you with us?
Okay, I'm with you now. Fantastic.
Hey, listen, I thought we had hard internet service here outside of the Tetons in Yellowstone National Park. What's going on in your neck of the world there, huh?
Don't know, in France, and I don't speak for the French people, but apparently they've had some problem laying out the fiber. But anyway, we won't get into that. But I'm glad I'm back on. I was like, oh my God, we've disappeared. Anyway.
Well, it's live. If it can go wrong, it will. It always does. There's no two ways around it. We just got to roll with the punches. You know, we're dealing with all kinds of fun stuff trying to just go live. It's not just as simple and straightforward. So with that, Glenn, here we go. I want to know everything about you from the moment you were born to this very moment in time. And so does Mandy. I bet there's things Mandy does not know. We want everything all the way back to the hospital when you were born. Do not leave out any of the good gory stuff, or we are going to call your mother. But listen, man, you only have 2 minutes to do it, and we'll come back to you right after you give us that
okay, squeaky. No problem. My mother gave birth to me in Australia, and I lived in Australia for 40 years or so. And then I've moved to Europe, and I've been here in the last 5 years, but I got involved in the hemp industry about 5 years ago. And my business partner's a builder. I'm more about the environment and business. And, you know, it's like I'm here in France because I'm close to our business partners that we have a very good relationship with. I'm really passionate about the environment, but I'm also passionate about making sure that everybody wins out of this scenario. So, you know, I think that the way to go is for, you know, sustainability. I'm really into what we're doing. I'm really into what Manny's doing. I'm really into what you're doing, Dave. I mean, I think it's great that everybody's spreading the word out there. And as you said, I think in some of your introduction, it's like it's time to look at using other construction methods. They're going to be a lot more sustainable and a lot more healthy for people. So, anyway, that's me.
For sure. I agree with that. So before we kick this off, I know, Glenn, you had some videos you wanted to show, and I think it's a really good introduction to what we're going to do here. And I know when you got kicked out, the video got kicked with you as well. But I think for people to really, truly see this product, understand it, it's going to open up a dialogue, and we're going to continue this conversation. And while you're pulling that up, Mandy, you know, we go live on Twitch. Do you know why we go live on Twitch, Mandy?
Audience? The audience you talk to?
Yes. You want to know why? Because the young people aren't coming to our industry anymore, and that's where they are. So we go live on Twitch as well as the other, platforms, because we're going after that audience. Nobody knows technology better than the younger folks today, and we need them to help us grow and take our business to the next level. All right, Glenn, I see a video there. You ready?
Yeah, sure. This is just a quick introduction of how quick and easy it is to get the hemp blocks happening for your walls in your commercial or your residential construction. So off we go. I click play and that's it. Okay, so there we go.
So, you know, I mean, if that was concrete, there's no way one person could lift that up like that. Oops, we're getting some feedback. All right. If that was concrete, there's not a chance somebody's going to lift that like that. And then it's an interlocking block system. I think I'm getting feedback from your other YouTube thing. Is it still playing, Glenn? Yeah.
Sorry about that. Yep.
That's okay. Yep. So let's kind of talk about this product and just walk us through what we are looking at there. From my viewpoint, it doesn't look like concrete. It almost looks like rock wool, like a tightly bound rock wool, the way it's compressed and all the fibers. Can you kind of give us the overview of what the product is, how it's made, and some of the process?
Yeah, no problem. It's actually made of two materials. So there's the wood from the hemp stalk, and there's the binder, which is the prompt natural cement, which comes from one of our business partners, that binds the hemp fiber together. So in the manufacturing process, this is all mixed together. It's then vibrated down, and then it's compressed into the form that we need it for the blocks. And then it's dried over a 6-week period. And then we install it on site. And as you saw, it installs very quickly because there's no mortar jointing. So, I mean, it's fairly similar to laying a normal cinder block wall. And then there's a load-bearing system that's incorporated into the walls at the building time. So there's about three different types of blocks. So the only additive to the mix is water, obviously. But what we've done is we've overcome a lot of the, I suppose, it's a, you know, what was the problem? I mean, hempcrete's a fantastic material. There's people that have built hempcrete houses in the United States and all over the world, and they're fantastic. They've got a superior quality. But the problem with hempcrete in situ, it requires special equipment, specialist training. There's formwork that you need. You need to pack it down. It takes time. And then you need to wait 6 to 8 weeks for the walls to dry before you can actually put the render on or whatever service needs involved or whatever. So our products actually solve the problem of actually that, because, I mean, apart from the cost factor, I mean, you know, if you're going to do hempcrete in situ, well, it's not going to be cost competitive with traditional building materials by a long shot, because you've got lots of labor and you've got lots of, you know, different skills that are required. Whereas with the block that we've got, it actually requires less skills to build this type of wall than it does a brick wall or a block wall or a timber framing wall. And the other thing is that, you know, the insulation value of just this one product, you need 2-3 levels or layers of materials to get the same with the cinder block. You need a rigid foam board, and we're talking about a minimum value of R28. So you want to compare apples with apples. Well, you know, you've really got to look at it. I want an insulation value of this amount. So what do I need to do? Hemp blocks provide that in one material.
Yeah. So let's just take a step back on this. And I see Mandy smiling as well. I mean, Mandy, even in my eyes, I could stack those blocks the same way as in that video. So when we talk about the lack of less labor that you need, or the lack of skilled labor for this product versus mudding and pasting and right lifting, and you got to be strong. So, you know, to me, this product not only allows for the less skilled labor, but it also allows for a different workforce to come in, one that isn't as strong as what we see the typical masons, where their thumbs are the size of my forearms, right? like people in the industry, for one. And two, I hear what you're saying about the production side of this, but to me, it would make sense as this grows and you can grow this product at four times the rate of lumber, there has to be a backside cost savings to this as it gains popularity and more people potentially use it. No,
not just,
that's a lot to unpack there, isn't it?
Not just in the production of the product, but the labor included, Glen.
Yep, absolutely. I mean, look, I see a number of things at the moment that are favorable to the market for us, because we've done a lot of market research. One you mentioned before, Dave, skill shortages in the United States for building. Also, too, there's a house shortage. So we're bringing a product to the market that would require a builder and a labourer, and you could whack up a 2,200 square foot house in about 4 or 5 days for the walls, put your roof on, and off you go. So, okay, the price of lumber, yeah, it's increased. It's been an advantage for a short time, but you know that's starting to come back down. That's a cause of the COVID. Anyway, you know, I sort of think that it's interesting to me. Well, I look at builders' margins in the United States. They're around about 7.68%, you know, which is not a great deal. So if you have a lumber prices going up and people aren't buying houses, well, you know, that's a bit of a problem.
Right.
But, you know, everybody's in business to make money, let's face it. And hopefully most people are in business to make it a life better for other people, which I'm all about, because we're going to have a healthier living environment. But yeah, you want to be able to sustain your profitability. So it's like you don't have to go and change how you build houses. If you know how to build a cinder block house, you can build a hemp block house. So you don't need to take on any extra training or anything like that. You know, it's pretty basic stuff. So, you know, to me, it's like, well, you know, we solve a number of problems in the marketplace as far as cost goes. If anybody's listening, well, you know, we're cost competitive with cinder blocks and we're much less than double brick and timber frame. But we're not trying to compete on cost. We're actually looking at, okay, you want this? Okay, no problem. Like in Australia, we're expensive because shipping from France to Australia is expensive. But people that want our products and we build houses for, they don't care. They just want it. And it's like, great.
Yeah. I mean, that's exactly it. And people, you know, housing is such a need and we have such a shortage of it globally. We have to find alternative ways to build because we're not getting it done doing it the way we've been doing it, whether it's offsite, whether it's hemp, different product. And we believe, or I should say we, a lot of people that tune into our show believe that, you know, the building suppliers and manufacturers are going to play a big part. And the products that we use and the change of how we build things moving forward. So you're absolutely right. People want what they want. They're going to build what they want. And the younger generation wants that healthier, more sustainable home. And we're going to get into all that. But listen, everybody, if you are just joining us, Mandi Kerr, Glen Donoghoe is on the show with us. We are live on LinkedIn, YouTube, Facebook, and Twitch because the young people aren't coming to us. So we are going to them. Mandi is going to co-host with me because she is an avid streamer. She knows the rules of how we do all this stuff. So why don't we just take a moment and just say hi to a few folks. You want to do that?
Yeah.
Sound
hi,
good?
T. Right. Aaron, it's good to see you. I'm really glad. Yeah. Vinny, of course, I'm always excited about you. I'd be interested in, some of the questions that are posted and asking. Well, I don't know if there's an opportunity.
Yeah, we're definitely going to start putting some of those in. So let's just kind of work through a couple of these because there are some people up here. I think, go ahead and read it, Mandi. I'll put them up and we can read through them.
Excited for this one and to learn about how hemp can reduce petroleum-derived building products.
Well, there you go. Why don't we just start with that? That's all. That's kind of a question within a comment, right?
Sure. Yeah.
Glen, who wants to take this?
You want to throw anything to the petroleum side?
Well, I got no idea about petroleum paste products anyway, so I can't make a comment. All I know is that hemp blocks are all natural. That's it.
One thing I do know is it competes, you know, pretty competitive with anything petroleum due to just breaking down to the cellular level. The same, you know, it breaks down to a polymer, and so we're the same level as a polymer and are able to compete.
Yeah. I think that would be another interesting conversation for the show, right? To really talk about that portion of it, because as we know, it takes petroleum and gas and oil and all the fun things out there to make just about every product out there. And there is a cost associated with doing it.
I'll interject then. So with our fabrication facilities, it's like I worked out that we could probably in the United States and Australia anyway, because we've got plenty of sun, we could actually put sufficient solar panels on our facility to provide all the power we needed to run the factory. And also we could probably also collect all the rainwater off the roof to provide all the water that we needed. So we'd almost be autonomous.
Love it. Awesome. Well, I think we'll get back to that, Ian. I appreciate you pulling that one up for us. And that is a great topic for us to go to. I don't know why my screen keeps popping to that one. All right, let's say I'm going to run through a couple quick hellos real fast. Good morning from hot Phoenix, Arizona. George Ryman in the house. What is happening, George? Great to see you. Definitely. All right, we also have Michael Rude Jr. Finally, let's talk about hemp and alternative building materials. Man, gotta love Michael. Ooh, Ben Hershey in the house. Hey, this is one of our sponsors, Ben Hershey Forward Solutions Group. Always a big supporter of us growing our industry and trying new things. Ben, I mean, you're out there all over the place. You're dealing with factories around the world. It'd be interesting to see if you're starting to see hemp products fall into the market because you're seeing it from all sides. Here we go. Here's one for you. Peter Molinar from greetings from Toronto, Ontario. What is happening? Peter says now Wednesday is now known as Hemp Day.
I can handle that. I can get on board with that.
That is awesome. I bet you could, right? Wednesday Hemp Day, national holiday is what we'll get into here. Man, there is a lot of comments coming on. We're going to be here for a while. I hope you guys took the afternoon off.
That's all right. It's evening for me, so.
Yeah, I saw you've got a good drink there. I need one. I've got milk. Hey,
you got milk? Rosé française. C'est très bien. It's after work for me, so sorry.
Well, let's keep moving here. We have an hour, and then you're making me thirsty, Glenn. So we're going to share a drink right after the show, my friend. Andrew Wilkinson, hello, everyone from the UK. We're going to run through a couple more hellos. Ruth Shamai, I don't recognize that name. Thank you so much for joining us, Ruth. I love when new people are popping up. Hello, everyone from Gabriola Island, BC.
Hi, thanks Ruth.
Thanks for joining us. That is awesome, awesome, awesome. I'm going to move down the road here and see. Hey, I didn't know this. Michael says our founding father, George Washington, grew hemp on his farm. Who knew? I bet they don't teach that in my 13-year-old's history class.
They will. They will soon.
They will soon, right?
It's coming.
Peter, I have anything to do with it.
I love it. All right, moving on. Here we go. You want to read through that one, or would you like me to read through it, Mandy?
Go ahead.
Yeah, and Mandy, just because we stream on all the different platforms, there's a couple of the platforms that the questions don't show up on the screen. So that's why we read them out loud. Hello, everyone from Dorset, Vermont. I'm an architect and the founding president of the U.S. Hemp Building Association. Our goal is to support and advocate for hemp building materials, hemp building professionals, and hemp building projects. Great to see everyone here. Please reach out if you want any part of creating a new industry. Thanks. There you go, Bob. Thank you so much. Like, these are the kind of connections that need to start happening and the collaboration that needs to start happening as we go through growing our industry and changing what we do. We're also going to say hi to Jose. Hey, Jose. Thank you. DTE Materials is manufacturing and engineered hempcrete high R value at scale domestically in the United States. Did you guys know that? Currently undergoing full certification with IBC and IECC, process compatible with hemp stock variety. Not sure if you guys know each other, but you know, it sounds like there's some synergy and some collaboration that may need to happen there. Do you know each other, Glenn?
No.
But yeah, I mean, this is great.
It's very interesting for me because one, as I said to you earlier before the interview, was that you know, I see in America that there's been a lot of growing about CBD. And, you know, everyone grew CBD. And now the CBD market sort of saturated as far as agri is concerned. Everyone, a lot of people are turning to industrial hemp fiber, which is great. So, you know, we're talking to organizations that are either already got decatechation or hemp processing facilities in place.
Yeah.
And we're looking at putting hemp block manufacturing next to those because, you know, we want to manufacture locally in the United States because, as Mandy sort of mentioned, it's all about, you know, win-win, and, you know, we can add value to local economies by providing money for people that grow the stuff and also then jobs for people that want to work in the factory and also then, you know, people that are building with it as well. So, you know,
right.
To me, it's like I like that.
Yeah, no, for sure. And I think, you know, bringing jobs to any economy is always a great thing, no matter how we do it. And bringing manufacturing locally always makes sense for so many different reasons, carbon footprints and all the other things that are out there. As we call it on our building science show, we call carbon disaster, not even a footprint. It's a disaster what's going on. Ruth says, I work with, I guess, Kana Systems. We build, and this is a question she's asked, we build a decorticator to separate bass fiber from herd. Critical first step between growing hemp and producing herd for hempcrete questions. Is that kind of the process on how they separate it? And what is a decorticator? I don't even know how to say it.
Decorticator takes, strips the fiber off the hemp. Is that right, Mandy?
Yeah, off the herd. It separates the different parts of the hemp.
Because I think the great thing about hemp is that you're a farmer or you're a processor, and you've got all these products from one plant. So we're sort of using the waste, the wood waste from the plant, but okay, it can be used for hempcrete in our blocks or other things. There you go. You've got a packet.
Let me see. I'm going to blow that up.
So these are just different sizes of the herd. Yeah.
So, you know, there's a number of revenue streams from an acre of production. And I was like, that's really awesome. So, you know, it's like, I mean, you know, can you come up with anything else that's doing these sorts of things?
Right, right. All right, here's a question. Let's get to it. We got Michael Rude. What other materials besides hempcrete are being investigated for building materials? Well, we're just talking about hemp. No, I'm just kidding, hempcrete.
So well, it's insulation, hemp fiber insulation is a big thing.
Okay.
You know, that's starting to happen quite a bit in the United States as well. And believe that, you know, there's an enterprise that's already getting themselves together to do that as well. And plus hemp wood. Hemp wood's a fantastic product. I mean, the guy that's selling that is awesome. We got people in Australia that go, yeah, we want a hemp block house, but we want hemp wood floorboards and so on and so forth. And it's like hemp wood is in America. It's fantastic.
Yeah.
I love it. What's that, Mandy? Go ahead.
And of course, plastics. You know, any type of graphene, batteries. You know, there's
really
that's being made and done.
Mm-hmm. So batteries and plastic are all coming from hemp.
Mm-hmm.
I did not know that.
Well, you can actually add graphene to the mix, and obviously that stores electricity as well. So it reduces the, you know, it's like you if you add this, then you're adding another, I suppose, value to the product as well, where you can do other things with it too. So, I mean, it's a bit ridiculous. I mean, you've got 20,000 uses for a hemp, and not just building materials. I mean, it's quite phenomenal. Yeah. I'm looking forward to, because there's a guy in your association, Mandy, that builds hemp panels for sports cars. Mm-hmm. Awesome.
Sports cars? Is that what you said?
Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. You want a sports car? Bruce will build you one for $100,000 and it'll be all out of hemp. And it'll go.
I love this. Listen, everybody. I mean, listen, the comments are lighting up. We only have an hour show. We're already 45 minutes into it. So put a queue if you have a question in front of your question, because it's getting pretty difficult to find it. I know, Mandy, you're probably watching the conversation happen as well. So if you see something that's very pertinent that I'm not seeing as we go through this, please let me know. But I do want to make sure that I say hello to the person that introduced us, right? Good old Aaron Peterson, Draper, Utah in the house. Love seeing to great networks on. So Aaron is one of the most networked people that I know. Honestly, a big fan, Aaron. Thank you, buddy. I really appreciate you being on the show. And another comment is from Ben, because this is very pertinent. Ben has a lot of experience globally. Hemp wood is also an interesting alternative used as an OSB or plywood alternative. Maybe a beam, et cetera. So we do think we're going to start seeing the hemp wood and everything else move forward as we go here. Yeah.
Yeah. And, I mean, I've seen what Greg, is it Greg Wilson, Mandy?
Yes.
I mean, I see what
reached out to him today. Mm-hmm.
What he's doing is just absolutely awesome. And the rigidity of those sort of products are just incredible. I mean, one thing I'm looking forward to is like, okay, we provide hemp blocks to build sustainable houses, but I want to see, hemp biocomposite used for window frames, building frames, and then you've got hemp wood for other things and solar and so on and so forth. So what's the point of just building a house with just this little bit? Why don't you make a fully sustainable home? I mean, everything's there. Yeah.
Well, it's funny you say that, because Aaron Peterson is saying, sweet, how much per block? Can I send you plans and you can tell me how much we need?
No problem. Absolutely. Send us some plans and we'll work it out for you. It's not a problem.
All right. Mandy, read this one out loud.
What are the moisture concerns during the install process?
Not a concern at all. We've left blocks out in the rain. We built walls and they're out in the rain. It's not a problem.
So it has a natural wicking process, right? That's what you're saying. The air, the way we were talking offline, the air moves constantly, I guess, around and through the fibers, and it doesn't cause
any moisture. Yeah, that's right. You've got a lot of air gaps. So there's a moisture buffer barrier, the air crosses the blocks there and the size of the particles and so on and so forth. So, I mean, look, you could put a block in a bucket of water and just pour water through it, and it's like water going through a pot plant. So, it's not an issue. And also, too, as I said to you earlier, is that because the hemp is mixed with a lime-based material, whether it's our natural prompt cement or others, the blocks actually carbonize, so they petrify over the 100 years plus of a building. So you're not only sequestering or sucking in carbon during the growing process, but during the life of the building, it's still carbonizing and petrifying. So you're actually sucking in carbon out of the atmosphere, which is quite phenomenal, really.
Yeah, I would. You like that, Mandy? That's right. It is phenomenal. When you really think about the environmental benefits of this, it's impressive. And we were talking also before you got on, Glen, and I'm going to interject one. Not only that, but from a safety standpoint, when we think about the air we breathe, what we breathe, or fire safety, your product doesn't burn. That's what you were saying. It won't catch fire, right?
Well, the thing is, okay, fire is one thing, especially in Australia and in California, we got wildfires and stuff, right? But, it's mold resistant, and mold's a really bad thing. You get black mold in your house and you're crook as a dog, and sorry for the dog. But also, too, with termites, it's highly alkaline, so you don't need to put any toxic chemicals in for termite barriers or the termi mesh or whatever you want. So, my question is, why would you use hemp block? Seriously. I mean, but the answer is, why wouldn't you? That's it.
Yeah, for sure. All right, we got some more comments coming through here. Let me just go up a little bit because I've dropped down.
I've got a question that I saw from Ruth that I'm curious about. After you build the hemp walls with the blocks, is it necessary to purge them? And what does that mean?
What do you mean purge them?
Oh, purge.
Because they're still wet?
Purge them?
Because of the moisture content?
No, not at all. I mean, you build them, and then you put your lime render on and whatever treatment you want to do in the inside, as long as you've got the ability for the materials that you're rendering or putting on the inside where the air can pass through the blocks. Because if you don't have that passage of air, you're going to block the control of humidity and the the energy efficiency of building is based on the building envelope. And that's why you put insulation and so on and so forth. So, no, it's not a question of doing that.
Cool. I wasn't sure.
Perfect.
No, that's good.
Steve Burrows, DTE Materials is the way to go. Hey, listen, if you guys don't know Steve Burrows, Steve is the guru of all guru things, and he's not afraid to be controversial in his conversation. Had him on the show not too long ago, but Mandy and Glenn, I highly suggest both of you make that connection. Super great guy too. Happy he's tuned in. Thanks, Steve, for tuning in. I'm going to put up, Aaron had another question here. It says, do you only do the wall install for the purpose of the GC, is his question. Also, have you done these in a modular facility yet? Interesting.
Well, I mean, you know, the purpose of GC, what's GC?
General contractor. So when do you just make the material? Do you do the install as well, or you just supply the material like a block company?
Okay, fair enough. Okay, so what we do is we supply design and engineering support services. Because, you know, we're not licensed in the US to provide engineering certification in different places. But basically, you send us a design, we work out how many blocks and what types you need, and then we'll actually work out an estimate or a quote for you. And also, too, if your engineer's got any questions about certification, so on and so forth, we can actually work with them, but we are building material suppliers, but we do have those additional services because, okay, this is a new system, but at the end of the day, it's not too different to putting in concrete blocks.
Yeah, for sure. We got Vinny up here. Hemp blocks are amazing. Does Glenn and his company have any certification for the construction industry?
I do.
Oh!
We have... the hemp blocks have had 40 different independent tests, and they've been accredited under various international and European standards. And what we're finding is that, for example, in Australia, we've got one building code, but we've got 547 local governments want to administer the building code. So what we're finding, it's on a case-by-case basis, and it's up to the engineers to look at the structural component, certify that, and sign it off. And we're finding the same thing in the United States where you've got 50 different building codes and so on and so forth. So we are working with architects and engineers. And also, too, it's like, well, you know, the testing that's been done and accredited in France for these particular products is already accepted in the United States without waiting for the ASTM to work out their, you know, standard testing regimes and so on and so forth, because it's all based on international standards.
So the answer is yes. I love it. All right. Andrew Wilkinson, what are the fire strategy, moisture strategy, acoustic strategy for each country? Do they meet with regulation/codes?
Okay. So fire rating, 95 minutes. Acoustic minus 43 decibels, and the moisture rating is 2.53 grams per cubic meter. I think, I don't remember quite, but anyway, they are all there. So, I mean, look, when we work with people, it's like we're more than happy to provide you with the information that you need to get your building past the regulations.
You know what? And this is. But before we go to the next comment, Steve Burrows back in the house. If anybody's watching the show, if they reach out to you, I'm sure you could provide them with any of the details. I'm sure these comments are going to keep going. We could probably stay here all day. But just for everybody out there, if you do have a question, we don't get to it. Glenn, Mandy, I'm sure we'll get back to your, you know, with an answer as soon as we can. And yeah, there's a lot of interest in this.
Yeah, well, I mean, look, we've got, you can go to our website, hemblockusa.com. You can send us a contact from there. You can look at me on LinkedIn. You can also, I've got telephone number as well, I think is on LinkedIn there too. So, you know, my business partner's a builder. I'm the business person. So, you know, we work quite well together. And, so the question is,
yeah, so go ahead, Mandy, read that one from Peter Molinar.
In construction with hemp blocks compatible with HempBLOCK compatible with passive housing or house principles for airtightness?
Yeah, passive house. So passive house is net zero living for the most part, right? It's energy efficient, it's healthy, sustainable building practices. So far, it sounds like it is.
Absolutely. I mean, hands down, no contest. That's all I can say.
It's definitely at the front of the conversation for true sustainability.
Well, I've never come across anything like this. I mean, I am a bit biased because I'm into this these HempBLOCKs and stuff. But I mean, realistically, it's like, can anybody come up with another material that you've only got, you know, three layers, a render layer, a block layer, and a, say, a gyprock or a plasterboard? You go, everything else, you need to use rigid foam board with traditional materials, or you need to use fiberglass insulation bats to provide the same level. It's like, are you going to get the same indoor air quality? Are you going to get the same comfort with acoustics and all that sort of stuff? No. I mean, unless I'm proven wrong, I haven't come across anything else like this.
Agreed.
Here's your answer. I love when we have a show and Glenn, you have all these answers, and Mandy as well.
I don't know everything.
Hey, listen, you know more than me, and that's what I like to do is surround myself with people smarter than me, and you two are killing it. Thank you so much. Okay. I love it. All right, what do we have? We have some more comments and questions. That's it on the comments and the questions as they keep rolling in. Listen, so I know there's a lot of you out there, and there's still things that are popping up. I'm actually seeing it here. In fact, there was one. Hold on one second. I see Jeff Conley put in a comment. Is there an ideal cultivar of hemp which provides the best herd for hempcrete?
Well, on that question, you can't make hempcrete blocks from, for example, CBD plants because they're too short and the wood's not great. So that's one thing. So I'm glad to see in the United States the increase in the production of industrial hemp because that's, they're better plants, they're better for what we use and all that sort of thing. Also, too, the quality of the hemp used to produce hemp blocks depends also on the decortication, so stripping off how you do it, stripping off the bark or the fiber from the wood and so on and so forth. So for us, it's a bit like Colonel Sanders and the 11 secret herbs and spices. It's like, you know, we've got a particular quality that we need for the hemp herd and also the way that we actually manufacture and the type of binder that we're using, because it's not a lime binder, everybody. It's a natural cement. We're a bit different to the rest of the world. But at the end of the day, it's like, yeah, sure, the hemp herd quality is critical for us in our manufacturing of these products.
For sure.
Our value is around about R28.
R20. So I think he's saying per inch. So you said it's R28 for the entire block. How thick is your block?
The block is basically 1 foot high by 2 foot long. So I haven't done the calculations down to an inch. It's like, why don't you people work in a metric? But anyway, we have converted everything to inches and feet on our American website, HempBLOCK USA. But look, I'm more than happy to have anybody email me, glenn@hempblockusa.com, with any questions. Quite happy to answer them. Quite happy to have discussions on whatever.
Perfect. 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 What I'm thinking, Mandy, is we need to talk a little bit further in Glenn and say, why don't we get everybody in the industry that's using hemp products and building with hemp, whether it's beams, plywood, wallboard, block, structural materials. And I think what we should do is set up a panel. Let's set up a panel of all of us, have a 2-hour conversation on this. I think it would be one of the biggest global conversations you've seen in a long time, because there are so many people looking to build here in the United States, not only from in the United States, but from other countries. And this is a really hot topic right now. I can just tell by the people that are tuning in, there's some big names here, which is great. Bob Escher, hemp is materials the green industry has been waiting for. Come on, world, let's start constructing hemp homes now. And that's from the UK there with Mr. Andrew. So,
well, Well, you know, it's happening because, you know, our French business partners, they've done a couple of hundred houses in Europe. The Israelis have done probably about 50 or 60 houses. We've done quite a few houses in Australia. We're designing quite a lot of houses in the United States. So, you know, it's all happening and it's encouraging to see. And, you know, as I've said probably before with you guys, it's like, you know, we don't have to chase business at the moment. I mean, there are so many people that are just like, yeah, we want to do this. Like in Australia, we had really bad wildfires. In California, you did. And we got people going, yep, we know we've researched this and we know that hemp's actually fireproof. So we want to build our house back from the ground out of hemp. It's like, oh, awesome. Or somebody else is going, well, gee, we've done the research and we know that these things are actually cheaper and better to build than most traditional building products. So
sure.
Well, I'm pretty excited about all of this, but like I said, I'm a little bit biased.
Well, I think, go ahead, Mandy, sorry.
I was just gonna say I would be more than thrilled to join in on a panel or put a panel together. It's something we do on a monthly basis at the association is what we do, Q&A panels and discussions. And so I invite anybody else to join in and participate. And then Dave, whoever, you know, whatever topics we want to bring together, I would be excited to collaborate and help introduce you to some of our, you know, companies that are producing and some on a, you know, local and global
scale. I'll second that because ever since I joined your association, it's like, wow, you've connected me with so many amazing people, including Dave. That's like fantastic. You're doing a great job and highly recommended.
Oh, yeah. Good. Well, thank you.
I love it. Mandy, you are doing amazing things. I've heard amazing things about you. It's very clear that you have such a passion and a drive to pull all this together. So we are going to do this. I think it's when we wrap up the show, maybe we can take a few minutes here and we're going to wrap up the show in just a second. But I did want to put up what Rye said. I think I said her name right. Rye McCurry. In the U.S., there is a huge need for more processing plants for industrial hemp. There's a lot being grown, but not enough processing capacity. So a lot has to be sent to China or elsewhere overseas for processing. Now, this goes back to what you said earlier, Mandy, about we need more processing and manufacturing here in the United States. And we're getting super, super close to that really starting to happen, right? Glenn, you're looking at a plant. We just found somebody else that already has a manufacturing processing plant that's taking place here in the United States. And I also think if you can grow this stuff four times faster than wood, and we can get the products that we need out of it, and we can do all the things that we need to build out of hemp, and it's more sustainable and more environmentally friendly, I think the whole thing just makes a lot of sense. And as the volume picks up, the cost will come down. That's the way I see it.
Well, at the moment for us, it's like, you know, we're cost competitive anyway. But if you're building with hempcrete in situ, well, that's expensive. So like I said, it's like if you want to build with hemp, you can do it now because it's the same price as building a blockhouse, basically.
Right, right. For sure, for sure. All right, well, listen, everybody, this has been an awesome, awesome show. We are going to obviously bring more of this topic. It was a big topic today. Mandy, Glenn, if you guys could please go answer any questions that pop up on this. It is live on LinkedIn, YouTube, Facebook, and Twitch. And we've had people joining us from all of them today, which is great. If you are not following Mandi Kerr, CEO and founder of the Global Hemp Association, you need to go follow her right now. Clearly, if you are not, that's a mistake. And also Glen Donoghoe, who is the director of GeoSIP Trading, as well as HempBLOCK Australia and HempBLOCK USA. If you are not following Glen, outside of he has a really cool accent, you're wrong. Go and follow. And right now, please like and share this so we can spread the word. And also, we always ask, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. You can watch all of these videos before and after anytime you want, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Because, hey, right now, Mandy, we're being consumed 24 hours a day. Our channel is being watched constantly, which is fun, and we're having a lot of fun with it. All right, everybody, listen.
Hey, Mandy, thank you very much. Awesome.
Yeah, we appreciate both of you, and we're going to see a lot more of you here soon. Mandy, I think you're going to co-host some more shows with us. So everybody else out there, have a wonderful, wonderful week. We are coming to you live from the national parks where Mandy is actually from. Lucky you. This is a cool place. Other than we need to get some internet signal out here.
I hear you.
That's it. Well, no, for a guy that lives on the internet, I've been going through withdrawal. You're going to have to check me into a clinic.
It works really well. I was having a glitch in the whole thing.
No, it pulled off well. All right, everybody, that's a wrap for today. Okay. Thank you so much for watching Dave Cooper Live. Glenn, Mandy, you guys stay right there. I'll come back to you right after the outro. Okay. Bye now.
All right. All right.